Hi, I'm Joanna.
And I'm Ella. We created this cool video about sea lions and epilepsy. In this material, you'll find an interview with Scott Baraban, a professor in the Department of Neurological Surgery at the University of California, San Francisco.
By making this video, we wanted to show how science is used to deal with our daily struggles and how basic research can be translated to clinics to cure human disease. We had so much fun creating this video, and we hope you'll enjoy it as well.
Once we heard the story about a pioneering surgery on a sea lion, we thought it was worth sharing. The more we learned, the more fascinating the story seemed. Let's start from Cronut. Cronut is an 8-year-old sea lion from California. He was diagnosed with a serious medical condition that is epilepsy. Sadly, he developed it because of toxic algae blooms that are damaging to sea wildlife. Due to global warming, the temperature of the oceans constantly increases, which leads to more abundant algae blooms. And since climate change is progressing, the problem will only become more serious.
Cronut was rescued and treated with anti-epileptic drugs that turned out to be inefficient. A life-saving surgery was the last option to rescue him. The whole project required a collaboration between scientists, veterinarians, and neurosurgeons. The surgery employed a use of a novel therapeutic approach that is transplanting the so-called progenitor cells into the brain to restore an impaired neural circuit.
Let's take a closer look at epilepsy itself. It is the most common chronic brain disease that affects people of all ages. We commonly associate epilepsy with tonic-clonic seizures, which is basically jerking and shaking. However, it's not always the case. People having seizures can lose awareness or start staring blankly into space, sense unusual smells or tastes, or feel a tingling in their arms or legs.
Seizures are usually unpredictable and often dangerous. They increase the risk of injury, hospitalization, and mortality, and can affect a patient's mental health, often resulting in anxiety, depression, or cognitive impairment. There are not very many therapeutic options, and even with therapeutics, almost one-third of patients do not respond to treatment at all.
For this reason, there is a need for new drugs and therapies. Professor Baraban's lab studies new methods of treating drug-resistant epilepsy. For example, his lab tested multiple drugs on zebrafish and identified the one called clemizole to be efficient in treating epilepsy. It is now tested in patients in clinical trials.
On the other hand, Professor Baraban's lab tested the progenitor cell therapy on a mouse model that proved to be safe and efficient. And thanks to these findings, he was invited as an expert to apply this approach and save Cronut's life.
We interviewed Professor Baraban when visiting his lab at the UCSF. He told us more about his work and outlined the importance of basic research in treating epilepsy.
Let's start from the beginning. Could you tell us about the research in your lab and what is your main research focus?
Sure. So the laboratory studies epilepsy. Epilepsy is a fairly common neurological disorder. About almost 3% of the world population has some form of epilepsy. We focus particularly on untreatable forms, basically what are called medically intractable epilepsies. And there are two general varieties, those that occur in children, usually pediatric epilepsies where there's no available drug treatments, largely because they're rare genetic epilepsies. And on the other side of the spectrum, adult epilepsies that don't respond to treatments, so acquired forms of epilepsy that adults have. The laboratory uses two kind of approaches to study epilepsy. One utilizes genetic models in zebrafish, larval zebrafish, and the other uses acquired models in larger animals, with the hope of kind of figuring out roles of therapy, you know, translational kind of roles toward that.
All right. Could you tell us about the sea lions issue here on the West Coast?
Sea lions.
Yeah, and particularly Cronut's story?
Sure. So for about 15, 20 years now, which is increasing because of global warming, there are what are called algae blooms. The algae here on the West Coast concentrate a toxin, a neurotoxin called domoic acid. Domoic acid gets in the food chain, and eventually larger animals like sea lions and sea otters consume enough domoic acid that they get poisoning. And that poisoning usually consists of killing off certain neurons in their brain. Those neurons are usually located in the hippocampus, which is an area central to learning and memory and navigation, as well as a region that's implicated in epilepsy. These animals have been turning up on the beaches for a long time, and they're collected by the marine mammal centers. There's one here in Sausalito in Northern California, and there's one down in Southern California. They turn up on the beach, are usually disoriented, they've been observed to have seizures, and so over the years, during the rehabilitation stages, they've been rescued and maintained in captivity for short periods of time, and they've been treated with various anti-epileptic drugs that are used both in humans and in animals, and no success in treating them. Cronut specifically, what we deal with Cronut involves something called progenitor cell transplants. So we've been developing a project for almost 2 decades to harvest embryonic tissue that is destined to become inhibitory cells. So there are two types of neurons in the brain, excitatory and inhibitory cells. Inhibitory cells, which was discovered by one of my colleagues, John Rubenstein here, originate in a region of the embryo called the medial ganglionic eminence, and the caudal ganglionic eminence is as well. And so they make specific types of interneurons that migrate and populate our nervous system. My other early collaborator, Arturo Alvarez Bulla, had found in late 1990s that if you transplant that fetal tissue into another mouse, those mice will get new interneurons from these MG transplants. So working with the two of them years ago, we started to transplant these cells and show that they functionally integrated as inhibitory cells. And that makes a lot of sense for something like epilepsy or even autism or other disorders where you have less inhibition. And so to get to Cronut, we had to combine two possibilities. One, of course, was working with a large marine mammal, which we really didn't have any precedent for doing neurosurgery techniques on them. And the other was to develop a cell source to transplant these cells, where we would find these cells. So Mariana Casalia, who was a very talented postdoc here at the time, started to pursue the idea that we would just use larger species as donors. So rather than using mouse cells, we started to use pig embryos. And so working with University of California, Davis, the veterinarians there, and other groups, we started to develop pig cells as a potential donor source for these transplantations. Once that was in place, we then started to work in parallel with the Marine Mammal Center and some of the neurosurgery residents here to figure out a surgical approach where we could deliver the cells to a large animal. And that involved a third collaboration at UC Berkeley with Ben Inglis, who was doing MRI in these animals, so brain scans to look at the brain. And so as you can tell already, something like Cronut seems, when it appears in the news, like a spur of the moment type of event, but actually it took many years of planning and, you know, 20, 30 different collaborators to make that happen. And so it turned out Cronut specifically was stranded several times and collected by the Marine Mammal Centers in 2018 and 19 for seizures, and was eventually adopted by Six Flags Discovery Park in Vallejo, which is up here in California. And one of the vets there fortuitously had seen me give a talk at the Marine Mammal Center about this project we were planning to do with sea lions to transplant cells. And it turned out that he gave me a call because they were about to sacrifice Cronut because he had been having a lot of seizures and lost about 25% of his weight, wasn't responding to any of the anti-epileptic drugs they were on. And so that led to us kind of scrambling together to do a transplant on Cronut.
Could you tell what are the similarities and differences between sea lions and humans' epilepsy?
Right. So epilepsy, of course, being a spectrum, the sea lions only represent one form of human epilepsy, but they closely mimic something called temporal lobe epilepsy. So patients with acquired form of epilepsy called TLE develop a loss of cells in their hippocampus. The hippocampus atrophies, it gets smaller, and there's some structural reorganizations. When you look at the hippocampus of domoic acid poisoned sea lions, it looks almost identical to those patients. And so in terms of an anatomical finding or pathology, they completely mimic human TLE. They also seem to mimic them in terms of the response, in that about 30% of patients with TLE don't respond to available anti-epileptic drugs. And Cronut had been on two anti-epileptic drugs and also was unresponsive in controlling the seizures. So from a pharmacological or treatment perspective, they're also pretty similar to that group of patients who are medically intractable.
And could you tell why do we use animal models in basic research and
sure.
How possibly it serves in therapy development?
Sure. So to be clear, Cronut and the sea lions are not an animal model. They're naturally occurring wildlife that just happened to get epilepsy because of the domoic acid poisoning. And so we don't actually generate, or they're not a model in the sense that they started and we made them from scratch. In the laboratory, we use animal models that mimic human forms of disease, because it's efficient to in a wide scale, in a large scale way, to test therapies and get a better understanding of the disease that simply would not be possible in humans. And the example that we use here more commonly than mice even is to use zebrafish. So zebrafish models allow us, which are also vertebrates and are genetically similar, allow us to model genetic forms of epilepsy very easily. And they harbor the same types of gene mutations. We can knock those genes out. We could study those fish. And the advantage of an animal model like that is really apparent, because one experiment with zebrafish, which is where we use the larvae, can be 100 or 200 larvae per week. So you can imagine, if you're like screening for drugs like we do, you can't do that with mice. You definitely can't do that with people. The relevance, though, for humans is that these discoveries that happen in animal models, whether it's our lab or labs around the world, are what leads to drugs that people actually take. Drugs are not tested in people randomly. They're tested in animal models that mimic diseases. They go through a safety process with the FDA, and those drugs that you take or use come from some animal model somewhere.
Right. And how would you explain progenitor cell therapy in simple words?
We're putting back a type of neuron that people with epilepsy lose. It's the simplest way of thinking about it. If you have epilepsy, you lose an inhibitory cell, and progenitor's cell therapy allows us to put those back.
Mm-hmm. So what are the challenges when it comes to progenitor cell therapy in human patients?
Right, so progenitor cells, and I want to be clear, because this often ends up being confused. Progenitor cells are fetal tissue, so we harvest them, they're post-mitotic. We don't grow them in a dish or anything like that. They differ from stem cell technologies, which sometimes get lumped together. Stem cells are derived from a human cell and turned into neurons. They're not at the same stage of efficacy for things like epilepsy or making the types of interneurons in this case that we use. And so this is not a stem cell therapy, but it's a progenitor cell therapy. Progenitor cells have the advantage of because they're post-mitotic, they're never going to form a tumor. Human stem cell derived protocols still have that risk because the cells are pluripotent. They also have a unique ability to migrate and integrate in the host circuit. And so that's very promising as a therapy, because they're doing exactly what their endogenous forms of cells would do. The steps to get this to humans, of course, involves proof of principle, which is Cronut's one example in a large animal that this is actually efficacious and safe. Cronut is now 9.5 months post-transplant. He's doing great. He's had no seizures in that time, and his weight is above his original weight, and he's been back to normal, as normal as a sea lion and life would be.
And how does your research, and in particular this project, serve society?
How does it serve society? Well, because people have epilepsy, we think there's a direct connection between what we do and society. The zebrafish examples, which we didn't talk a lot about, but we have zebrafish models for rare genetic epilepsies. Drugs we've discovered in zebrafish are already in clinical trials for patients with those epilepsies. So the translational side of the lab, I think, has a direct impact on hopefully medical care for these patients who are suffering with intractable epilepsies. From a larger perspective, we think it helps society in understanding that there's a value to this kind of basic science. And it's not theoretical, it's actually practical. These things could eventually be applied to helping humans, whether with epilepsy or other types of disorders.
Perfect. Thank you very much. These were
sure.
All my questions.
No problem.
Summing up, epilepsy is a heterogeneous disease caused by an excessive and abnormal neuronal activity. Animal models in the biomedical field can be used to gain a better understanding about the mechanism of the disease. This allows for drug development and testing.
Like in this case, the progenitor cell therapy was proved to be successful in mice, and this knowledge was used to save an epileptic sea lion. Looking far ahead, this approach could be used in treating epilepsy in human patients. With this example, we can see that the basic research is reflective of real-life issues and has a great impact on our lives. At the end, we would like to thank Professor Scott Baraban and Dr. Catherine Salvati. It was a great pleasure to visit your lab and talk with you. Finally, thank you all for watching, and see you next time.